I'm a full-time consultant now. I've worked in nonprofits for about 17 years, starting out as a community organizer for an organization called GLSEN, the Gay, Lesbian, Straight Education Network. Do you know it? Yes. I saw a smile. I love that. Yay. I worked with Gay Straight Alliances, or GSAs, in middle schools and high schools around the country, dealing with bullying, anti-LGBT bullying in schools, where I helped also bring the National Day of Silence to become a national event, as well as Ally Week and some other week events that we do. Some campaigns that involved around half a million students in 5,000 schools each year around our country. And these are students who were protesting the bullying or the silencing of LGBT people in our society. From that, I also was a tech geek who, back in high school on an Apple II computer, taught myself how to build websites. I saw the power of technology during that time in the late 90s to really connect single or small groups of LGBT students in rural communities around the country and help them feel part of something larger. And that's how I got into digital engagement, marketing, and communications today. I also work, if you read the fun thing, the non-nonprofits. I've started tapping into celebrities lately. Anybody know America's Next Top Model and Miss J Alexander? Okay, he's fun. And then Janet Mock, a wonderful author and activist, a trans activist who came out with a book, Redefining Realness, that we got her book to become a New York Times bestseller last year, and now she has a new show so popular on MSNBC. Tune in Fridays at 11 if you want to watch. It's a lot of fun. So, as was already said, definitely tweet with me. I'm at Chris Tuttle, 501 Tech NYC. Oh, it's that way. If you haven't taken this poll yet, this is a quick poll that we did online. You can access the poll if you want to add your opinions to it. I'm gonna update this. The poll's not gonna update live here. These are other people's votes. But we started about a month and a half, I think, ago, asking folks online how are they currently using metrics. Not at all, a little bit, occasionally, actually taking action on them, or obsessing over them in real time. This let me know that Jeremy Bivens was not actually taking the poll, because I know that he actually obsesses in real time over metrics. But please do share your opinions. I would love to know how you use metrics in your day-to-day work. I will be creating a follow-up blog post on my website from the session, from the topic, and we'll be using some of the information from here. Okay, today we're gonna talk about social media metrics, primarily around the topic of engagement, the overused word engagement. We're going to talk about what we can learn from metrics, some quick takeaways, and we're going to highlight metrics gathering through Facebook, Twitter, and social media metrics through Google Analytics. We'll also talk about some quick tips to get us started. Yeah, it doesn't like me. So what does successful social media engagement look like? I'm curious. Opinions, thoughts. What do you consider successful social media engagement? So replying back, so two-way conversation.
Likes and shares.
Likes and shares.
I would say even shares more than likes, because it's you have to actually stand behind, like, this goes on my profile, mm-hmm. Now I'm sharing it, so that's, I think, a more successful engagement than just getting a like on something.
Very possible, yep, sharing the like. This is the conversation I hear quite often, is it simply the likes that we get on a post? And you know, how many of us actually post something even on our personal pages and go back and look an hour later and it has no likes and we feel let down? It happens. Is it about our reach? Is it the number of people we've reached with our message? And reach is defined very specifically by Facebook as those who actually saw our communication. Doesn't mean they actually read it, but it's those who actually saw it. We know it was served to them, as opposed to impressions, which is simply the number of times a post was shared on somebody's wall or profile. They may not have ever seen it. Or the big one, is it amount of money we raise via social media? Has anybody raised money via social media? Successfully?
Yeah.
Over 100,000? Okay. It's a little hard, right? We know that. Although this is typically the one that I think our executives want us to be doing. It's the first thing that I'm asked when I go in and talk about social media engagement is, how much money can we raise on social media? Well, you know, the truth is, I think it's actually a combination of these things, and that it really just depends on what your goals are. To me, successful social media engagement is what aligns with our goals. It's the metrics that can actually tell us whether or not we are achieving our goals or not. It's that simple. If our goal is to get our brand out there and seen by more people, it's likes and reach. If our goal is to actually raise money, then yes, it's going to be conversions of donors and dollars. And so first and foremost, we definitely have to know what our goals are. We're not going to talk a lot about this today, but it's just a reminder that if you don't know what you're trying to achieve with social media, you're going to have a hard time figuring out what you should be tracking. Because you're probably either going to be tracking the basics, the things that already come for free, or you're going to be tracking everything, which is going to be way too much. So figuring out our goals, aligning our metrics directly to those goals will help us be most successful with our social media. You can skip it, yeah. Okay, so some common social media goals that I hear is raising brand or cause awareness, it's gaining new constituents, it's informing our constituents about the impact our organization makes, and of course, it's actually those actions, those conversions, it's getting subscribers to our email list, it's advocacy takers on our petitions, it's donors actually donating to our cause. So if you don't know what your goals are, think of those as we go through this today. So what can we learn from social media metrics? Now, besides what we can actually learn on how many likes on a post and what that tells us, I like to actually break down social media metrics a little bit first in how often we should be checking them and the types of metrics in general and what they might tell us. So before we actually dive into those, I wanted to showcase these because I think this is funny. This is some of the basic metrics you can get on your Facebook Insights, which if you're like me, it's already too much, and it's not going to really help you out. Even worse is if you've ever downloaded your Facebook page's Insights, you see that? Yeah, I see the heads shaking and nodding. That first tab, and they call it Key Metrics. Those Key Metrics, thank you. Over 100 columns of Key Metrics for every single day, and that's only on the first tab. You have about 10 other tabs with additional metrics depending on how you're using your social media, whether or not you have promoted posts and so forth. This is often somewhat impossible to deal with. Does anybody actually download this on a regular basis and dig through it? You do. I love you. You're geeks, and that's fun. That's good. And there really is amazing data in there. It's just figuring out what's the most important and what you need to be paying attention to and throwing away the rest, right? Why don't we get involved in metrics? Well, there's overwhelming data. It's time-consuming dealing with all these metrics. Actually, I like that because I can see too. Thank you. It can be cost prohibitive of our time and our resources, our staff, to actually deal with it. We're not sure, or they're unrelated to our goals. We're unsure what the metrics actually mean or what we're supposed to do with them. Or like this chart, some of the metrics are completely meaningless. And yes, that chart is completely meaningless. So what I'd like us to do is to align our metrics with our goals and also in relationship to an engagement pyramid. And I hope a lot of us have heard about engagement and pyramids before, if not on social media via volunteer cultivation or donor cultivation. And I look at our engagement pyramid as this. It's the wide group of folks who are viewing our page, viewing our content, viewing our brand. A smaller group who are going to start liking and following, the ones who actually want to learn more. From there, we're probably going to have some folks who are commenting, then sharing, hopefully clicking on things, and ultimately converting. And by converting, that's the subscriptions, the petitions, the donations. Now, when I talk to folks about, or nonprofits especially, about what they want to get out of social media, the thing I hear every time is donations, subscriptions, petition signers. This is where everyone wants. But a lot of us aren't thinking about all the work we have to do to get there. We have to attract the views and the people to actually engage with us via likes and follows. We have to tell the stories that make them want to learn more and keep in touch with our organization. We have to ask the questions and share the stories that are powerful enough that comments come back to us. We have to engage and reply to those comments, as was mentioned. We want people, of course, to share, to be brand ambassadors, to become the ones who are sharing our message on our behalf to their networks and reaching more people so that we can continue to drive them up this engagement ladder. Now, the further we go up the ladder, the more we drive from listening to action, it's also going to be the harder it is to achieve. I truly believe that the harder it is to achieve, though, really the better it is both for our organization and the constituent in the value of that relationship, the value of that engagement. Also, if we think of our communications as trying to communicate with folks along the continuum of this pyramid, then we can also think about different types of communications we're sending out so that we're not simply asking people to subscribe, to donate, to take an action, but we're also telling the stories that get the views, the likes, the comments, and the shares. You might also look at these in three different categories, the bystander, the community member, and the leader. And these are some typical actions they may take. And I do want to say about the pyramid and as well about this, it's not an exact science. There's not going to always be less clicks than there are shares. Some content we know very well may get more clicks than shares. Some may get more comments than others. It all changes a little bit depending on what the content is. But we can align these to some of our brand awareness goals. We can align these types of actions to some of our community building goals. And we can align these types of actions to our activation goals and hopefully getting more specific about what the actual goal is we have and how we want to activate users. So this is where we're going to break it down by type. And I break it down by metrics that we can view on a daily basis, or what we call drive-by metrics. Monthly metrics, which somebody said it earlier, do on a weekly basis, which is great if you have the capacity to monitor, maintain, and actually take action on weekly metrics, more power to you. I find most nonprofits don't have that, and so I usually suggest monthly is where we look at our page and our post metrics. At least quarterly, I like to look at our demographic metrics and who's engaging with us. And I don't do it more often than quarterly unless we're in the middle of a campaign or some new initiative, simply because I find that most of our demographics don't change that greatly from month to month. And then as needed, our campaign metrics. Those are going to be the metrics really specifically around our campaigns. When I talk about campaigns, I'm talking about an initiative that has a clear beginning, middle, and an end. It's going to be an end-of-the-year appeal. It's going to be a fundraising drive for a new office space. It's going to be a petition to get certain legislation or policy passed. Those are all campaigns. And in between the campaigns, we have other types of communications that are going to talk about our impact, our work to keep people engaged. But think of it as valleys and hills, and that our communications are going to be ongoing and our campaigns are going to be the peaks. Campaign metrics can be incredibly useful because we can actually look at what a campaign achieved and how it worked, and we can take lessons from that and utilize it in our further campaigns or our follow-up campaigns. And then automate where possible. And I loved, who was it actually? Was it Whale? They said that you automate weekly?
Yeah, we harass you weekly with text messages.
I love that. I can't believe people want weekly harassment, but I love it nonetheless.
50 confused nonprofits have decided to do that.
More power to them. That's great. So drive-by metrics are going to be those that we see as we use social media channels. In the past, these are going to be the ones that just the likes, the comments, the shares that we can all see. It's public data. I can see all of yours. It's actually changing a little bit more. Has anybody seen the new Twitter mobile metrics? Love it. I think it's amazing, although I get a little too wrapped up into it sometimes. On mobile apps for Twitter, any tweet sent out from your account, there's a view more stats. And you can see detailed engagement metrics around how that specific tweet did, which is pretty cool. But it's drive-by. Like, we're not going to change a whole campaign necessarily because of this. And on Facebook, we can see the basic metrics that come. We can also go to our insights and click on any post, and we can see very detailed metrics of how that post performed, and very specifically where people clicked and what they did. Again, this is drive-by. You're probably not going to look at every single post, detailed metrics at the end of every month. It's a lot of data. But we can drive by and we can see opportunities for engagement. I can see, this is actually something we just shared this morning, I think it was. And actually, which one was that? No, that was a couple days ago. But this was actually performed incredibly well for this organization. And I can see very clearly that this is a story that we wanted to share again. So we did reshare this story. I do a lot of Great Apes work as well as LGBT work. Completely not connected. Except for by the same funder, that's true. But we can spot emerging trends. We can also see potential problems, especially content that people aren't engaging with or that people have negative responses to. And that's going to be the drive-by just by in our daily usage. Actually, I just want to say real quick, because this is one of the only ones where it actually shows the organization's name. All of these screenshots are all taken from a variety of sources, some mine, some others. I try to limit access to seeing whose they are, just to, you know, for their privacy. Arcus is actually one of my larger clients that has actually teaches me or pays me to teach people. So they appreciate when I use their metrics as examples. So you will see theirs. I'm not giving away any trade secrets. And then whenever you see bad metrics, it's usually my account. Monthly metrics. These, I think, are the most important metrics we can tackle, because it's not too much, it's not too difficult, but monthly metrics enable us to determine what content types our constituents are engaging with, how they're engaging, and it can also help us forecast seasonal trends. I typically see across a few different nonprofits that we see social media decline in December. I don't know if anybody else has seen that or not. I see a couple heads shaking, yes. And it took us a couple years to figure out that that wasn't us just having a really bad month, that it was actually just an ongoing trend. But so we do have both Twitter and Facebook in these examples, some monthly metrics. We're going to dive more in detail into those and what they mean and what we can get out of them. Demographic metrics, the ones that we're going to be looking at least quarterly, are going to help us know who our constituents are. And I think this is one of the most fascinating ones. Do folks in here know who the demographics are on social media? I see a few hands. There's some really great stuff in here. One, I can just tell where people are from, what other interest levels. This is a Twitter screenshot of followers. This is a Facebook. I can see age ranges and gender breakdown depending on the service. And one, that's just interesting to know, of course. But two, if you're using Facebook targeted posts, you can see here what are the best states, cities, or countries to target your post to, where you have the most followers or the most engaged users. A targeted post on Facebook is where you actually limit who can see it based on a criteria, like where they are. So I post often about a New York event, and I may lock it down only to be visible to New York City folks. If you aren't using it yet, look into it. It's amazing. Especially because, as we all know now, Facebook is limiting our reach more and more every day, and we're only able to reach maybe 2 to 15% of our constituents or our existing followers. So if I can target those to be more specific to the content I'm sharing, then I'm going to have increased engagement on that. No, this is free. And that's the trick. Nobody seems to know that. For free, you can target any post based on gender, based on location, or language. I think there's also an interested in, but I don't trust it. And we have to note about these targeted posts real quick. It's not 100%. It's relying on constituent data that's been submitted. So a lot of folks are actually on one of my accounts. We just noticed it earlier this morning. One of our accounts, we noticed that 10% of the people who follow our account do not identify their gender. We actually think it was a Facebook account. We actually think they probably identify in one of the new 55 genders. And so they're not actually being considered as part of the male or female demographics yet. So it's not 100%. Some people lie about where they actually live because for privacy reasons. Some people hide that data entirely from us. So it's going to give us different information. The other thing we can also do from here, both on Facebook and Twitter, is see where our biggest following is. And we've used this for national organizations to figure out where to have offline local events or local meetups, where we know we have existing followers we can reach out to. On Twitter, even more interesting than Facebook, in my opinion, we can see who our followers also follow, which can show us people we might try engaging with content with in order to reach more based on topics and content that we know that our followers are already going to be interested in. So if the majority of our followers follow, Barack Obama is a bad example, everyone follows him. But actually in this is Bell Hooks was down here. Bell Hooks is a feminist author and speaker. So we had 20% of our followers also follow Bell Hooks. That's amazing. So we knew we could then have conversations on with bell hooks on Twitter or try to initiate conversations. More people would be able to see them, especially using Twitter's reply functionality that would limit who sees that content. And it also helps us figure out countries. And so Ms. J is actually a great example. Ms. J is globally known. And Ms. J is very popular in Asian countries. And so when we're trying to figure out how he's going to do tours and who he's going to work with, and yes, he identifies as he, and his name is Ms. J. We actually look at this to figure out where we're going to go. And I apologize, there were two questions, I think.
Yeah. The Twitter one, is that embedded or is that like an actual app or something?
Nope, it's part of Twitter Analytics. It used to be part of ads only, and now it's completely free to everybody via analytics. I'll go into more detail about how to access those at the end of the presentation.
Chris, sorry, the other question, just before you move on with Facebook, considering any posts to your pull list will only be seen by, 1 to 13%, are you shooting yourself in the foot by further limiting that to a particular region, for example?
Not if you do it wisely. So usually when I'm doing, so Arcus Foundation, which is a client of mine, is a great example. We do a lot of local events around the country, or our grantees do local events, and we're often advertising those events. This one we just did in New York City, and I wanted to advertise it. And what I'll typically do is I'll do a multiple post. We'll do at least one public post that everybody can see at some time, and then we'll do a follow-up post or another post that's limited just to the New York audience. The great thing about that is if 2 to 5% of our followers are going to see it, the limited post is going to ensure that 2 to 5% are in New York City, or at least say they're in New York City. We still do the public post because some people don't identify accurately, or because we know that people have friends and will forward information along. So we'll typically do both and try both. I do find, though, that targeted posts, they won't have thousands of engagements depending on the number of followers you have and depending on your engagement levels, but the engagements they do have will be more meaningful.
But it's not like 1 to 2% of the 1 to 2%. If you have like 10,000 followers, so then you have you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like three people are going to see your post.
Yeah, well, we don't know exactly, because Facebook won't tell us exactly how they do it. What we do know is if I have 1,000 followers and 100 identify as living in New York State, and I target content to only be visible to New York State, it's going to only show it to those 100. What exact percentage of those 100, we don't actually know. I typically find the percentage matches if it was a public post.
Okay. But I would rather 2% of those people be seeing it being in New York City if it's a New York City event. Versus
2% of your total audience, not...
Yes. Yeah, I think it's still proportionate, though, to whatever you're segmenting. It's the same algorithm, you're just segmenting it to that defined audience.
Yes. Yeah.
Like if 100 people out of your 10,000 would have seen that post, it'll still be the same 100 people, but New York-based 100 people. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
More likely to be New York. That's what we're hoping for. Well, if they identified as being in New York and we're targeting to New York, then we know at least they say they're there and it's going to be targeted to them. Facebook's, there's two different types of posts. There's kind of like a fence gating targeted post, and then there's a priority posting, which is usually more aligned with boosted posts. So in boosted posts, we can say boost this, but only boost it to New York residents. The fence gating targeting is where we're saying only show this to people who identify living in New York. Another place that actually comes in very helpful is with languages. So we will often create posts in Spanish, very popular language on most of our organizations, and we'll write them in Spanish and target them to people who identify as speaking Spanish.
The one thing I was going to say about segmenting posts, there's two different kinds.
Yeah.
There's just limiting it to the news feeds of certain locations, and then there's actually like making it visible to
And they call them both targeting.
Right, and what we always used to do was just limit it to the audience, mm-hmm. and that means if you're just limiting to New York State and you live in Connecticut and you went to our Facebook page, you won't even see it.
Yep. And that's the targeting I'm talking about.
Oh, is that more effective than just a news feed?
I think it is.
Oh, because we usually just switched. That way, people who, even if you don't live in that state where you're segmenting to it, and you go to the page, at least you see that the organization's working on that whatever. So.
Yeah, I plan actually the what I call fence-gating targeting, which is actually ensuring that it's only those who identify that way, is actually more effective. Because it ensures that it's only those people who see it.
Yeah.
So the percentage of the people are going to be in that area.
Can you clarify where you do that versus the other?
No. Facebook just changed the second one, and I never used the second one. Do you remember where it is?
Yeah, basically, you set up a Facebook post, and you're right before it's ready to go, there's two different options. One is the one you're talking about, where it's only visible to those people. I think it's right next to the post button.
Yep.
It kind of has like a little globe icon. And then the other one is just segmenting to the news feeds of those people. It kind of looks like a compass symbol.
Is it a compass or a targeting symbol?
Yeah, some sort of targeting symbol. And that's more in the left corner,
bottom left corner.
Facebook keeps changing it.
Yeah.
And can you do it for pre-scheduling posts?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
But not when you share from another page.
No.
And you want to pre-schedule.
Sharing anything from another page sucks on Facebook. I think we've all figured that out by now. Right.
Do you have any experience with international audiences? Because my experience has been that these targeting tools they're not very useful.
Oh, we use them for Arcus all the time. Yeah, Arcus is a global foundation funding great apes conservation and LGBT equality. And we use it all the time to target to specific regions. The thing that we do with targeting, and I said New York City as an example, and I should take that back. I would never target to a city, ever. I target to states and countries. And the reason being is people don't always identify as living in New York City. They may live in Manhattan, they may live in Chelsea, they may live in Queens, they may live in Burham Hill. There's thousands of neighborhoods that they could identify as living in, which makes it very, very complicated. And unfortunately, Facebook has not yet figured out that they should have a certain miles from option, which would be so amazing. But they haven't figured that out yet, which would be nice because they could have more of my money. So I always do states. So whenever I do a New York post, we typically do New York, Connecticut, New Jersey, depending on what the content is. I find it incredibly useful for countries. Are you thinking about? Yeah, I would target the whole country. I typically avoid the countries that we know that a lot of Facebook spammers come from. So Turkey, Egypt, depending on the organization and whether or not we have to communicate with them. So we will target to the country. You have to keep in mind time zones, and you have to keep in mind local usage. And that I think we're so US-centric here in our work and our communications that we often think that, well, everyone else gets to work at 8 to 9 a.m., and so they're checking social media at the same time. And that's not necessarily true. And then you also need to think about your audiences. It's a little stereotypical to say this, but I just saw it this morning when I was reviewing metrics with one of my clients who has a very young audience, under 30, and their audience is online from noon to midnight. That's it. So when we post first thing in the morning, especially on Facebook, it doesn't really go anywhere. If we post around that peak time, noon, and I usually try to post about an hour before our peak, then we find it's actually more successful. So it's knowing your audience, knowing where they are, and also knowing the local habits and customs. Okay? Campaign metrics. Again, Arcus approved. Campaign metrics, we can learn how constituents engage with specific campaigns, we can test tactics, and we can improve future campaigns. So Great Apes Giving Day was a giving day because we needed one more giving day, right? Great Apes Giving Day was a giving day focused on great apes. It was our pilot year this year. We raised $82,000 in a single day for 9 African sanctuaries that support wildlife rehabilitation and conservation for primates and primarily great apes. It was amazing. I got to go to Africa and work with them, and I loved it. We had incredibly successful campaign. Arcus does not have a huge following, so if you go check out their social media, we only have, I think, about 4,000 or 5,000 followers. And through a lot of our campaigns, we were able to reach 150,000 people per post via some very innovative kind of campaigns. And this one, each participating organization had their own picture, so each sanctuary had their own picture of one of their own primates. The first one, we had a little issue with them all serving great apes. And for every like their picture got, we gave the organization $1. And it was amazing how people shared that. We didn't promote it or pay for it at all. We just posted it and it went wild. And we were only, and I love this because it reinforces my belief that most of us are very stupid, is that, and I put myself in there as well, is that we only did it up to, I think it was for the first 1,000 likes across all the 9 pictures. We got
what was it? It was 15,000 likes. People kept doing it a week later, long after the campaign was over, because people don't read. Right? Okay. So we're going to dive into the metrics by source, and this is where we're actually going to talk very specifically about Facebook, Twitter, and Google Analytics. And this will be fairly fast since I've also covered some of the stuff. So Facebook Insights comes with every page, not a personal profile, just a page. And you can easily get your drive-by metrics, your monthly post and page level metrics, your demographics that we've talked about on a quarterly basis, as well as any campaigns you're running. Campaigns are usually going to be specific to posts. So our monthly post, if you're not using this yet, you'll want to go under the post tab, and you'll want to very first and foremost check what type of content are you sharing that is people are engaging with most. Some of these screenshots are a little bit old, so they've changed. We actually know now that links on Facebook are performing a lot better. In this example, actually, links were not performing as well. But this helps us know what types of posts: text status, a photo, or a link. We also can look at specific posts, and we can go down and actually see how each one is doing in terms of engagement and reach. If you are using targeted posts, make sure you change this little tab to check out what's going on. Because when we actually switched to actually only look at our targeted posts, we saw that links performed much, much better. And part of that was simply that we were advertising local events and linking to a registration form or a more information form, and local people wanted local events. Not too surprising. So they performed pretty well. Our quarterly information is going to be under our People tab, under our Your Fans tab, and maybe even looking under our People Engage tab, depending on what you're trying to determine. But this is where we're going to find our gender breakdown, how we compare, our age and gender breakdown, and how we compare to overall Facebook demographics. We can see our country, state, and languages, and we can figure out ways of better engaging with folks. If you see in here, in your countries, if you see some of Middle Eastern countries, and you do not work in Middle Eastern communities, you probably have spammers following your page. And one of the great things about targeted posts is you can actually use those targeted posts to try to target the countries you do want to work in, so that you limit the reach to those other countries where people are engaging with you, to try to slowly get rid of them until Facebook shuts them down.
And how do you know that?
There's a lot of blog posts out there that I've kind of written about. I'm not remembering all of the countries. I know Turkey and Egypt constantly come up, and there's one other one. Do you remember it?
A lot in Southeast Asia. It's a known issue with Facebook. There are a lot of, especially on bigger pages, there's a lot of spammy likes out there. And so what happens when Facebook sends out a post, they test it to a small audience, and if that test audience is spammy, it's going to push down your post for not showing. So it's a known issue. You can find a lot of videos and websites.
It's all about get more likes, Facebook advertising.
Yeah, and they all come, and they're all, quote, legitimately purchased. It's kind of a scam.
Yeah, people were being paid below minimum wage just to sit around liking it all day.
Fascinating concept. Our demographics also under, we want to also check our people reached. A couple things here, so you can break this down. It's the same exact data. We can see our existing fans, the people we're actually reaching, meaning the ones who are seeing our post, and those who are engaging with it. Look across these three. If your stats are not about the same across all three, then there's a disconnect between the content you're sharing and who it's for and who's actually engaging with it. Usually the disconnect will be, you'll see under people engaging, is that maybe one gender is responding, or one age group is responding more than others. And typically I find that happens when we have one person in charge of writing our communications, and they don't necessarily know how to write in different voices or speak to different audiences, is we end up having people who are speaking to people like them. But we want to make sure we're speaking to everybody who's following us or everybody who's reaching, because we want them all to be engaged. So they should be about the same. And we talked about knowing where your constituents are can help us figure out where we might even do offline events. This was actually the clear example. We hosted, this was actually an LGBT event, and we hosted local pride events in every single one of these cities because we had a great following there already. And then historically on that monthly data, I like to take, and I'm still a little old school, I like to take, and these numbers are completely made up, I like to take all that data and take it out of the social network and put it into a spreadsheet.
a Google spreadsheet, Excel, doesn't matter. I like this for a few different reasons. One, and I would not just take every single stat you have, take the ones that relate to your goals. But one, I can actually compare across social media channels and see how social media channels are performing month to month. And I can also compare them to web. And if you're an Excel pro, you can also create amazing dashboards and find out your monthly, year-to-date averages, your year-to-year, your month-to-month averages, create nice Excel executive reports that you can just print out, PDF, and email around to your staff without having to do a lot of work, simply by having an intern input the numbers from Insights. If you do, actually, this presentation is available online. You can get it afterwards. If you do actually look at this, these source codes relate to the column in that Excel download for Facebook.
My question is kind of like backtracking and tying that, but about the like targeted posts in different countries and different languages. Because like my organization has an issue where we're kind of arguing like around the world about whether everything should be on one page or if we should have different pages for different languages. Mm-hmm. Do you recommendation opinion?
I don't know your organization.
I'd have to do a deep dive into your organization and look at where your constituents are, where your audiences are, how you're currently set up, what constituents you have in different databases, who I would actually do a check by creating a custom audience, especially in Facebook, import your database into Facebook, see how many of your existing constituents in what countries are actually connected with you yet, and whether it's even worth the efforts to try to even create that just from the start. I mean, that alone, it just really depends. I mean, if you're talking about smaller groups of folks in different countries, you might use something like groups to better communicate with folks as a kind of a secondary communication form to the official page. If you're talking about like Jane Goodall Institute, who I work with, obviously with Great Apes work, they clearly have different divisions and they have different regions and they have a Jane Goodall Asia, they have a Jane Goodall US and a Jane Goodall Europe, and they find it incredibly successful. So a lot more work. So Twitter, our drive-by metrics. This is where we actually can see from any of our tweets that we look at on our mobile device. We can see that view tweet activity, and we can get very detailed stats about how people are engaging, how many impressions, total engagement, which means any type of engagement, replying, sharing, retweeting, clicking on the link, and we can see some overall percentages. It's pretty interesting. I can't wait till they bring this to the web. Twitter as well. We also can see just from on the web, we can see how people are interacting, how many retweets we've gotten. Very simple. Our monthly analytics are going to be found under our drop-down now. You used to have to go to ads. You didn't have an ads account. Now there's an analytics button from your profile drop-down. Everybody has access to this. Oops. I still had a couple people tell me it may ask for a credit card when you go in there. It shouldn't anymore. They're supposed to be done with that. But even if it does, put in a credit card. It's for because they want to get you into advertising with them. You don't have to spend any money. You get the analytics for free. And the analytics that Twitter is providing, I think, are pretty amazing. You can also directly go there via analytics.twitter.com. And there's a few different things you have here. You have your impressions, which is the total number of times your tweet was served or possibly seen, does not mean reach. And then we have our specific tweets that we can see below, and we can see specific impressions, engagements, and engagement rates. The thing that I love most about Twitter's engagement is one, they've actually done a great job with allowing you to sort through all your data by month or by specific dates without having to export it into an Excel like you do on Facebook. But two is these little five boxes, and I think four of them are incredibly important. And the best one is the engagement rate. The engagement rate is the percentage of people who could have seen your tweet, or who did see your tweet, excuse me, that your tweet was served to, who had some type of engagement with it. Who retweeted it, who favorited it, who replied to it, who clicked on a link. Or, if you had a video, who watched the video. Any type of engagement. The average engagement rate on Twitter is reported to be somewhere around 0.2 to 2%. It's very low. Remember, this is the number of people who engaged of the total impressions that were made. But I find that most of the organizations I work with have fairly good engagement rates already. They typically are around 2% or higher already. So most folks are doing a really great job. You can also figure out this number for Facebook by doing the same calculation, by just looking at your total number of impressions and then dividing the total number of engagements. And you can compare the two, and you'll find they're actually very, very similar. It's one of the reasons that Facebook supposedly dropped the number of people that they're going to show your ads, or sorry, your post to, is because they realized that they didn't really have to necessarily perform better, supposedly. These are the five boxes that you can see along that left-hand side, and all except for favorites, I think are amazing stats. It's great content. I can see our overall engagement rate and what days we're doing better than other, and I can compare our monthly average or our 28-day average, depending on what we're looking at, to our past months to see how we're improving over time. I can look at specific days on all of these and see what's standing out. I can see link clicks very clearly and how what links are clicked. I can see replies and retweets. I don't think favorites is that big of a deal, just because I think we all use favorites a little bit differently. Some people favorite content they want to go back and see later. Some people favorite as kind of an acknowledgement that I saw you or I read it. Some people favorite things just because they're trying to get followers. So I don't care about that.
Sorry, one follow-up question. I wanted to see from my organization if our engagement rate had been changing over time. I was hoping to make the case to management that, wow, golly gee, our engagement, we've been doing all this stuff, and over the past couple of year or two, our engagement has been going up. And the only way to get to that was for me to export, you know, the report into a spreadsheet. I don't think they do the rate, it's just the engagement. But it was kind of like all over the place, and I couldn't see a trend. So it was like based on campaigns, and it was very like seasonal.
Well,
I just didn't know what to make of that.
Able to go back 2 years.
You could only do that if you, I don't know, it's very funky. You got to click on the drop down and you export the data, and it just gives you like a year and a half or something worth of data.
So from the drop down, you can go back to about a year.
If you click on October 2014, it gives you through October 14th to today. Yeah.
That's what I found, yeah. I looked at all my accounts before coming in today because I had a feeling somebody would ask how far they could go back. And it seems that they're all different. From a lot of my accounts, we set up for advertising back in the day, so we had analytics already being tracked. If you ever did that in the past, it's there, and that's great. Other accounts, I found it had our impressions here, going back anytime before, I think it was April of 2014, it had our impressions, but none of our posts anymore. So I haven't seen a clear answer on exactly how far back it goes. Other than that, if you were able to go back and look at some of your data, I wouldn't trust it more than a year old, just because this is all new to Twitter.
But fine, and even within a year, if you're just seeing volatility in your engagement rate, is that typical? Should I be expecting to see an increase in engagement rate over time if we're investing, you know, some resources? And
I think you should at least see around the same percentage, similar. It just depends. It's going to be who's managing the account. Is it the same person? Is it different people? What's the level of tweets you've sent per day? What was the content you sent? How compelling was the content? Did the content have visuals? Did it have video? Like, all of these factors determine whether or not somebody's going to engage with it. So you probably just had some days that were more successful than others. What I would do is, I would actually filter through on this one. I like to look at, so I do reports once a month for all folks or accounts I have, and we keep track of our monthly engagement rate just to see how we're doing. I also then go scroll through, and unfortunately you do have to scroll right now, there's not a filter, but I scroll through our past month's worth of tweets, and I look for all the engagement rates that are higher than our average to figure out what were the things we were doing well. And typically I'll find the three best tweets and the three worst tweets, and I'll copy them, I'll screenshot them, and I'll just save them. And I typically find it's almost always exactly the same. It's almost the best ones for our accounts typically have visuals. They typically are not old style retweets. They typically had a hashtag involved, and they typically were sent in the morning for our accounts. That's not gonna be true for everybody. The worst ones are random. Sometimes they met all those criteria and they just didn't perform. Sometimes it's usually that they were on a different time because we try to tweet 24 hours a day and keep things active for our global audiences. So you have to dig in and dive deeper. So this is what we were just talking about here. This is how you can actually go back and look at specific months. They have about 4 months that you can easily just tap. You can set your own dates, and you can export your data, and you can get even more detail. If you really need to get into more detail, especially if the metrics align with your goals, and you need to see where on a tweet somebody's clicking. Are they opening up an image into a full size so that they can see an infographic you're sharing? If they're clicking on hashtags, if you want to know how many people are clicking on hashtags, you can actually see that via your exported data. And our quarterly demographics, we showed these already in the beginning, but these are also great. Some people, besides the most popular, some people that you might want to engage with online. The locations you might look in outreaching to. And the topics, the most unique topics and the top interests of your audience. Can give you some really great insights into areas to tap into. This is not actually from an Arcus account, but we had a very similar thing happen on Arcus. And these tags are very generic and very general. Twitter figures this out based on the words we use in our tweets. They then put us into buckets of what we like, comedy, movies, whatever, whatever. It's not 100%, and just because I tweet a few times about something doesn't mean I always want comedy tweets. But we did this with an Arcus account, and we found that we actually had a large number, a large percentage of our followers who did like comedy, specifically in movies and TV. And so we decided to actually create some tweets that were very specific, still with our content around great apes, but that related to movies and TV, and we actually did find they had higher engagement. So it can help. It's not 100%, but it might be helpful. And I know I'm running out of time.
I was just going to say, I was on a session with Twitter today about this page, and they were saying that the way they figure it out is by the followers you have. And that if you're following a lot of nonprofits, they assume you have an interest in nonprofits. They don't necessarily do it by the words and the tweets, but by the followers.
Thank you for that. I appreciate that.
Absolutely. Differently. That's good to know. That actually makes sense. If you're following a lot of celebrities, you're going to be interested in pop culture or celebrity news. So that makes sense as well. Good to know. Same thing as before. We can take this to that spreadsheet. We can keep track of that data long term. And then finally is Google Analytics. We're just talking about social media metrics here, and this is very, very easy if you're not doing this yet. You can go into your Google Analytics, and of course, if you're using Google Analytics, you can dive into your social media metrics and find some really interesting stuff. But you can also go just create a new dashboard and check out the gallery. The gallery are dashboards that other people have built and made available for free. And if you just go search for social media dashboards, you'll find a number of them. And I find that this first one is a great place to start. It's the first one that comes up when you search for social media in the gallery. It has all the basics, and then from there, you can delete the widgets that you don't want, you can add the widgets that are more important, and you can prioritize the page to look the way you want. You can copy this and make multiple dashboards based on the same template, and this way you're not having to start from scratch and try to dive into those thousands of analytic options to figure out what widgets to put in here. And then the other big secret here is the automation. There's a little email button up here that allows you, one, just to email this dashboard. And this is true for any dashboard you're looking at, any page in analytics, but especially our social media dashboard. And we can email it to ourselves, but we can also make it a regular thing. We can automate this. So we can send weekly emails or monthly emails that are sending this dashboard either to certain staff or one of us, so we don't have to remember to go to sign in. We can do it to our entire communications team. I even love just to create a general Google Analytics dashboard about our web visits, about the top viewed pages, and we send it to all staff. And one of the fascinating things about it is it gets your staff invested in your website, because somebody will come from a certain program and they'll say, why does their program show up as the third most viewed page and ours is the 10th? And we get to say, because you haven't provided us updated content or a new blog post in a year. I'm being totally snarky. But it does help us do this. It is, unfortunately, it's only going to be active for up to 12 months. So just set yourself a calendar reminder to update it again. So taking all this knowledge, where do we move from here? Little quick tips, and this is what I do and would suggest you to folks do something similar. Schedule about an hour a month or more to review your analytics. especially depending on how many accounts you have and how many things you need to tap into. But I actually spend and schedule an hour every month to look at them, to dive in, to figure out what they mean and how they relate to your goals. Schedule about an hour a month to try to improve your analytics. This might be creating goals and funnels, and goals and funnels are very specific to Google Analytics, and that's the funnel that we want people to go through from our website and the different pages to the final conversion action, or the goal, the track we want them to take from coming to a landing page to an action, confirmation page. It might also be testing out creating social sharing links. So social sharing links are creating links on our website that ask people to tweet a stat, to a Facebook post, or share an image in our article. And like trying to improve. If we spend about an hour a month slowly trying to improve, we can constantly keep our websites up to date, we can make them better, we can make them more social, and we can hopefully improve our metrics. If we're trying to actually just make our websites perfect tomorrow, it's not gonna happen. And it's going to be outdated by in a month, right? Things change. Schedule an hour a quarter to review in-depth analytics. And this is getting beyond your dashboards. This is really diving in to say, okay, I've been wondering why these certain pages have higher bounce rates, and I want to fix them and ensure that our landing pages don't, that we decrease the bounce rate. I want to figure out who our demographics are. Google Analytics now does have built-in demographics. I maybe want to update our code so that we're collecting more specific data around our audience members. And then schedule an hour a quarter to learn more. And the best place to learn about Google Analytics, in my opinion, is actually at Google. They have tons of free training, tons of free resources. Anybody can actually take their courses and even become certified as a Google Analytics expert. And it's really great lessons, and it's a lot of stuff to learn. And Google Analytics is huge, and it's changing so fast that we have to keep up with it and figure out how it's going to be working. And that brings us to the end. So you can download this presentation at tuttle.co/MWM, Measuring What Matters. It was tweeted out in about 5 minutes. And if you were completely bored and yawning, you can follow my dog Luca on Instagram. Otherwise, you can contact me and ask any questions. And we can stay here and also take questions as well. Okay? Good. Thank you.
Minutes of questions, so if anyone has any questions, I'm going to ask you.
Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, do you think that Twitter will eventually go the route of Facebook and only show your tweets to a certain percentage of people that are following you?
They already do.
I mean, they don't do it in the same way Facebook does. Facebook actually uses algorithms to determine what your content is going to, or who your content will most likely, who will most like your content, excuse me. And they show a select audience, and they determine whether or not people will see your content, both from the page level and also our personal profiles. They limit what friends see our posts, and there's not a lot we can do about it. Twitter actually does the same thing, they just do it differently. Twitter shows real time. And that means if I'm not logged into Twitter, I don't see your content. So it really is already happening. It's just happening in a different way. I don't think they're going to create an algorithm to change that. I do think they will create more filters. So if anybody has a verified Twitter account, you already have filters where you can only see content from people who are also verified or people who you follow, or you can act as actually a specialist as well. I do think they'll come up with some more ways that people can filter through content. I don't think they'll create an algorithm simply because that's what makes them different. And that's what Facebook is jealous of.
That's why Facebook created Trending Topics.
I'm wondering what you think is the value added of Instagram on that. I don't know if they have social media metrics with Instagram. So what's the value added of it?
So we have drive-by metrics, and we can also do our calculations in Instagram, and there are third-party apps that will give you some really detailed information about your Instagram account. Iconogram, does anybody remember? What is it? Iconosquare, thank you. It's a great one that actually does, and it ties into Hootsuite, if I'm not mistaken, as an add-on app if you have a Hootsuite Pro account, and you can manage and see your metrics right there in Hootsuite, which is pretty cool. I don't focus aren't Instagram metrics in anything beyond a drive-by and keeping track of total followers way, simply because I don't find that Instagram is a great click-through or conversion opportunity. It's just a branding, behind-the-scenes, light-touch engagement opportunity. However, it's growing, and it's growing huge. You know, I have, So Janet Mock was telling me this morning that she hates Facebook and that she only uses Instagram. It's not the only one she uses. It's the only one she wants to use. She also loves Twitter. She absolutely detests Facebook. She hates signing in, and she doesn't ever want to be there again. And I think she's very in tune with millennials in general in the way they're feeling about Facebook, in that she's 31 now, 31 years old, and her audience is young. And they are on Facebook, and they do engage with her there, but they don't engage with her in any way similar to the way that they do on Instagram or Twitter. Those are her channels, and they work. Same thing with Miss J. I mean, Miss J's brand new to social media. He was an old celebrity who never thought he had to be on social media necessarily, or never, you know, really saw the need of it until things somewhat changed. And we set up all of his accounts about a year ago, and he instantly had 200,000 followers on Instagram. I know, wild. And he has like, I mean, he posts, and this is being recorded, so Jay, I love you. This is realizing that as I'm saying that. And he knows, I tell him this too. But he posts a picture of, what did he post? He posted a picture of a spider on his ceiling in the corner. It was blurry. It was not, he didn't use a filter because he doesn't like the filters. And it's a spider in the corner of your apartment. And he had 5,000 likes in a day. I'm like, I wish my nonprofits could do that. That's amazing. It works. It's where people are. And I think, as Janet and I were talking about, I think it's the ease of scrolling through and liking content or quickly engaging with short content, very similar to Twitter. I think it's why both of those work. I mean, we know from Pew Research that people do not read online. People read less than about 15% of any content we share via email, web, or social. We skim words, we look at graphics, we're drawn to the bold, the underline, the italics. And so knowing that we live in this in the moment now media consumer age, we need to appeal to that, and we need to actually provide content that's short, that's brief, that's to the point, that's engaging, that's visual, and that makes them want to do more. But to your question, because Instagram does not yet do the conversions, I don't track it much.
What about from LinkedIn? How low is average?
Actually, does anybody else know? I don't know. I'm on LinkedIn because I have to be. I hate LinkedIn personally, so I don't use it. And my brands don't use it because it's not a channel that we've just found successful for us. So we don't use it more than a brochure social media site, in that we create basic content and we automate using IFTTT, which Joe Moran loves, or Zapier. And we automate some of our sharing content both on LinkedIn and Google+, but we don't spend a great amount of time on those channels. Just for my clients, it's just not worth it. Does anybody know what's considered good on LinkedIn?
Okay.
So you do that for Google+ too, for like the improved search?
I automate the Google+, and I only use it for our owned content. So website, blog posts, things that we've actually created, YouTube videos, we automate all those to go out, and we will check to engage them. Sometimes we see more engagement than others. It tends to be very select audiences, especially tech, male-centric, younger, 30s maybe even. But I don't trust that Google's gonna keep it around, so I haven't personally just invested that much. I don't believe that we need to be everywhere on every channel. I believe that we should, and I do this every time there's a new social media network that comes up, and there are over 250 social networks around the world. There are tons of them. Every time a new social network comes up, not all 250, but every main one in the US, I register an account, I get our preferred name, and I set up a brochure page. So if people are there, they can find us and they can connect with us elsewhere. If the service is a medium-level service like Google+, so I consider low-level meaning like Elo, who used it, Medium level is like Google Plus, LinkedIn. We'll automate some stuff for those using IFT or whatnot, just to repurpose content from other social sites. And then we'll focus on 3 to 5 priority sites at most. If our audiences change on the other ones, we will rechange our strategy.
I recently saw on Facebook they were saying that if you upload videos, that they're going to perform a lot better than LinkedIn to YouTube.
Yes, they really do.
Yeah, it's
and they're punishing YouTube. Also,
if the content is good, though.
They're punishing YouTube uploads, and they're giving a lot of weight. Their algorithms are giving a lot of weight to their native stuff, and they're really punishing you if you upload YouTube.
And Twitter actually works better with YouTube videos because they show right in line with the tweet. Vimeo actually works better with Facebook and then inline Facebook videos as well. But content number one, content's king. If the content sucks, your stats are going to suck regardless.
So my organization has been on social media for quite a while, but they have not, I'm sort of leading the change in terms of asking about donations. And one of the arguments that I'm getting about the amount of time and energy we spend within our department trying to do this is about our constituency and audience base, and that they're like an older generation and they won't actually be doing this. Yet, when we ran a Giving Tuesday campaign this year, we did have quite a bit of traction. I mean, I'm not saying that we raised hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars, but I think it's a false premise to say that our people aren't there or that they won't do it. And I'm just curious if you have any thoughts or advice on a scenario like that where you know our direct mail is, you know, an older audience, but eventually they're going to die off, and sort of trying to foster this connection with the younger or mid-age, you know, people our age audience.
I think social media fundraising works best when it's not you asking for money, when it's your constituents asking other people for money. First and foremost, that's right now. That's not to say you should never ask for money on social media. There are ways of doing it. In fact, that one Great Apes campaign that we talked about for Great Apes Giving Day, where we received 15,000 likes on a single post, and we actually repeated that for all these Great Apes sanctuaries, had very low followers. And so creating a large number of individual donors. They were primarily funded via foundations and corporate sponsors or local governments in their countries. And so we knew that creating a Giving Day just for Great Apes was not going to be very successful if we had nobody to ask for money from. And so we actually created a social media campaign where we created these little social media tactics to build up energy and buzz and following for them. We wanted them to gain new followers that then they could reach out to and ask. And it worked somewhat. It worked for some of them better than others. And I think we can all guess this, but just, you know, if you're not familiar, it worked for those who shared stories of great apes, who had names for their apes, who could talk about a dire story of an ape in trouble. In fact, the photo we showed earlier, Bondi, I think is his name, was a small infant ape. That a chimpanzee, or no, actually that was an orangutan, excuse me, that was found in a cage behind in the back of a grocery store, and was being kept as a pet, and it was malnourished, and it was near death. And they rescued it about a month ago, and they've been posting about it about every week, giving updates, linking through to their blog and their website, and they've raised about $40,000 just by telling that story repeatedly and talking about, I know, right? And just talking about and telling folks about, you know, their experience and showing pictures and showing video. And granted, it's an infant great ape. It's gorgeous and it's cute. And everybody wants, and we're not supposed to say that. We're never supposed to call apes cute, but it's cute. They tell the stories, and then on the stories on the website, they do also ask for money to help continue rehabilitation and rescue. And it worked. Completely worked.
It's like a peer-to-peer fundraising.
Peer-to-peer fundraising.
By first starting with an ambassador campaign and then having the ambassador.
Yeah, use your board members for a fundraising campaign. Your major volunteers, your major donors, let them fundraise on your behalf and then tell those stories and then connect those stories to the need to raise money. And it's going to change too. You know, it's all going to change, but it's the same principles that we see in direct mail, same principles in email. It's just a new channel. It's just social media. Okay, we have two people. You pick. He had his hand up first.
Oh, it's me. So I guess you're sharing all these tools and all these metrics that how you capture, but what percentage, and this probably differs by organization, but what percentage of those metrics are you actually using when you're planning your digital content? And what would you say is probably a good...
Yeah, I'm not actually using a lot of the metrics to plan content. I'm using metrics to review how our content worked in the past month or the past campaign and to make changes in how we plan future communications. So I'm not necessarily looking at, except for some rare examples, and this is where the drive-by I think is important, like the infant ape. That was a perfect example. We saw that one performed incredibly well when we shared it, and it's from our grantee, and when they shared it, it was incredibly well. So that was something where we said, okay, we're gonna keep sharing this story every week. We're gonna keep talking about this. Otherwise, though, I'm looking more on a monthly basis to see trends and to see what types of communications are working, what types aren't. I also repeat content. If content worked really, really well last week or last month, I'll repeat it. I'll do it differently. I won't just copy and paste. I'll find a different quote, a different image, a different way of telling the story, but I'll still link to the same place. I may share it on a different day of the week or a different time of the day to try to reach a different audience, or I may use those targeted audiences to try to reach more specific audiences. But otherwise, it's more just impacting our overall strategy than it is our specific communications, if that makes sense.
All right, we'll let George have the final question.
This is fun. Can we just have a question and answer day where we have like a panel?
Did I not just talk about this earlier? In the works, Tuttle.
Assisted conversions inside of Google Analytics. Obviously, somebody who just joins you is not going to immediately donate. I'm curious, any benchmarks or experience you have looking at assisted conversions coming from social being one of, but not necessarily the last book?
No. Quick answer. No, you know, we definitely look at the channels and we look at where people come from and we look at their paths and we try to improve elements along that path to try to figure out how to ultimately convert them. But I actually have not seen that much of a difference of who comes to us via social, via who comes to us directly in terms of any of our actions except for donations. So subscriptions to email newsletter, signing a petition, polls, surveys. I find that very equally, it's based on the page that they've landed on and the content on that page and the call to action is more important than how they got there. That whether we've driven them via email, offline, or social, they typically act the same except for the fundraising. And you're right, yeah. If they're a first-time donor, they're typically not going to donate. There's an old study, and I don't remember who it was. There was some old study that we used to talk about at Black Belt, so maybe it was a Black Belt study, that talked about actually needing to actually have 7 touch points with a constituent.
Combio,
now Black Belt. Everything's now Black Belt. It was having 7 touch points we found was more important than anything else. That the more ways we touched or communicated, or a touch point is just an interaction and engagement with a constituent.
I know.
It's offline, it's phone, it's mail, it's email, it's social media, it's multiple social media channels, it's different types of content, it's forms, it's polls, it's surveys, it's our website, it's our blog. And the more touch points a constituent had with us, the more likely they were to donate. That's all.
I love that.
What?
I said touch your constituents.
Touch your constituents appropriately.
And with permission. All right, Emil, first of all, round of applause.
Thank you.